I was obviously on this path with you guys, and then I've just gone knocked completely off that path, and I wasn't exactly ready for this baby, but it's come our way, and this is how we're dealing with it. So we went back in for the scan, and then the doctor scanned the brain, and you could see his eyebrows were kind of going up, and it was like me and Sash were looking at each other thinking, what's going on? You know, is our baby okay? Risk of fine motor problems, which the doctors brought up quite a few times. Risk of epilepsy, risk of cognitive impairment, risk of visual impairment. So, you know, you're looking at quite serious stuff, really. So maybe someone's watching this podcast who's going through it, you get me?
Yeah.
So, you know, obviously I feel like I'm alone, but there's probably millions of people with this same problem. Like what I was saying earlier about, you know, potentially terminating the pregnancy. I feel like we're past that now. Like if the doctor said to us that there's a sliver of hope, then we're sliding in for that full pelt, you get me? And we're gonna have this baby, and whatever it is, whatever the situation is, it's gonna be loved.
What's going on, people? Welcome to the Central Club. This episode is brought to you by Reinspire Printing and Oh Snap Cardiff, and also Crane Locks. I want to say a big special thank you to Crane Locks as well for sponsoring this episode. If you haven't already, make sure you hit that like button, subscribe to the club, and hit the bell button to be notified of future content. Today's guest is very, very special. I always say it's special, but this one is very special. This is something that should have been done a long time ago. Someone who you know quite well. It's weird that he's back here, sat here with me today. You know, I told my story on the Central Club, and one thing we wanted to do was tell his story. But even since, you know, he's gone away, you know, there's been a lot of developments in his life, and he wants to come and share that. And also, I think we need to set the record straight with obviously how things went and why, you know, he stepped back, and why obviously Tom left as well. Yeah, you're obviously understanding him. I've got you now. It's Lukah.
Yeah.
What's happening?
Yes, bro. Fuck me. It's been ages, man, since I've been on this podcast.
I know.
How long has it actually been? It's been like...
I would say 5 months.
Ooh.
That's mad, really? Isn't it, when you think... Yeah, yeah. It's probably like 32 weeks, something like that. No, more than that.
Well, we've done the Christmas special...
Yeah.
Which was unbelievable.
Yeah, yeah.
What was the last one you'd done? So Michael O'Brien, you said you didn't do, which I was quite surprised about.
That's when I left. Well, that's when I stepped back, yeah. Was it?
No. Tanya's and Michael O'Brien's, because I remember I'd done Tanya on my own, but before that, yeah.
I was actually supposed to come in, I think, for Michael.
Yeah, he was.
And then, yeah, just life. I was obviously on this path with you guys, and then I've just... gone knocked completely off that path, and life just put me in a different direction where I wasn't able to put 100% into Central Club. So it, for me, it was a situation where I felt like being on the Central Club, I felt more of a burden than anything. So
yeah, you said that to me a few times, and it was sad to hear that.
Mm.
And I understand, because I know what you're like me, you have to put 100% into stuff. You are like, yeah. 100% dedicated, all in with something, and if you're not, you will feel like a burden, like you said.
Like we're quite similar in that way. I think so. Like I build stuff up in my head, and it has to go this way. Yeah. It's kind of like OCD in a way, isn't it? Because when it don't go that way, that's when you start stressing out. But then, for me personally, when I stress out, I tend to avoid things as well. Do you know what I mean? Like if it's not bringing me comfort, then I'll just literally abandon it. Which is, it's not a good way to live, I don't think, because you should be able to sort confrontation out right from the get-go, or if you have any problems or any discomforts, they should be sorted out straight away, because what I find is if you prolong it, you're stretching out that pain or whatever's going, do you know what I mean? You're not sorting it out, so the sooner you sort it out, the better, really.
Well, you know, I've missed you, man. Boys?
I've missed you, bro.
Boys?
I've missed him so much. Like, terribly. Like, we drove past him the other day, and it was literally... Well, anytime you see him, he just puts a smile on your face, doesn't he?
Yeah.
You can spot him a mile off.
Yeah, and I picked him up this morning, it was just hilarious. Like, he's...
Yeah, Lukah's Lukah.
Yeah.
We love him.
Nothing's changed.
Yeah, I I was thinking as well.
We're not serenading you here, by the way. We're not. Promise.
No, I know. I've missed you two guys because we were going on, you know, a year of the Central Club, and in that year we've been on such a mad journey, yeah. And we've bonded together, you know, and it's a ritual. If you see someone every Sunday or whatever, every day of the week, then you're gonna have that connection in you. Do you know what I mean? And like, even if it is for a brief time, for a day or all day, or
yeah,
I definitely feel like we've bonded. And this is good because me and Cullen wanted this exact thing. We wanted to have a family. The Central Club needed to be a unit.
Yeah.
And at times it wasn't like that. But look, this needle itself is in that way now, yeah, haven't it? Yeah, do you know
yeah,
what I mean?
So, yeah, I genuinely believe that. And that's why I said to you, because, you know, we'll talk a bit about, like, obviously what happened with Tom and with yourself. And because a lot of people probably thought that because Tom left, you just left as well. But that weren't the case. There's other reasons in your life that has taken you this way.
Yeah.
And, you know, I've told you, and I've said this, and I'll always say this to you, there will always be a space at the Central Club for you, no matter what. Do you know what I mean? Like, if you rung me and said, Carl, listen, you know, I'm free today. Can I come down? Of course you can. Obviously, you made this decision, which was like, you know, I'd rather just step away from it for now. And that's fair enough. That's fair enough. You know, and, you know, it's grown in its way as well. You know, I've been used to doing it on my own and I enjoy it. But it's you know, it's nice to have you here sometimes. And not just that, like, I know what you enjoy making other content as well. And I really want you to get back into that and do it.
That's exactly what I want to do, man. I feel like since I took my step away, because obviously I still watch the Central Club. I'm the biggest fan, do you know what I mean? When I'm watching the podcast and I'm seeing it's you and there's like one guest or two guests, I like that dynamic. And I think the viewers do as well. I think it's like a better dynamic in some ways. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah. Yeah. But I always would have liked to have had it where if it's something serious maybe and it's hard to get something out of them, then maybe it'd be a one-on-one. But if it's Andrew Biggie Morris, if it's someone funny, or I want you there, like you are like we have a laugh. And you bring out things in me, which is funny, and to the guest as well. You do have your strong points, Luke, 100%. Do you know what I mean? And I never, ever wanted you to feel any type of way that we were trying to push you away, because it was not that at all.
Yeah.
Hence why I'm telling you, come back.
Well, like, look, we're on the pop show now. And I want to say that I don't feel like that. And if anyone's ever come messaging you, because I'm like, you know, whatever people say to you, they obviously don't know the full truth. So here I am, I'm on the podcast now saying exactly how it is. Yeah. And I stepped away. It was completely my decision.
Yeah.
Completely. I wasn't thrown out or, do you know, anything like that. It was no malice. We've kept it professional. We're good friends as well. So it's not been.
Yeah. Yeah. I do look back at some pod episodes and I'm like, fucking hell, look at us. We're proper like bombarding the guests. And it was that. But there was three of us. But at the end of the day, like we knew what we were coming ourselves into. When all three of us stepped in, we said, how is this going to work? And it did work. We done well, I think, for a long time. You were talking about then sometimes, you know, it was always good. Sometimes it was, you know. It was. Sometimes it was quite volatile. I don't know, you kind of witnessed it sometimes as well, I suppose.
Yeah, obviously, like, it rubs off on you. Like, I could easily just step away and just be like, I'm just doing my job. I'm coming here to film. But I've always been invested a little bit more than that.
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
So, like, if I'm hearing, like, squabbles and arguments, I remember the classic WhatsApp scrap.
Which one?
This almost like broke me. I've said to you a couple of times, like, bro, I can't be doing this. Like, it's just not worth it for me. Mm. But at the same time, like, I remember watching or listening to those WhatsApp messages on full speed with my missus.
You have to, don't you?
Absolutely hilarious. Yeah. You fucking blah, blah, blah. Yo, my God. Yo, blah, blah, blah. The best, bro. I wish we could put that out, but out of respect for Tom,
we probably won't.
Yeah. But,
oh my goodness, you've just unlocked the memory in my mind, because I forgot, but I remember what you're on about now. There were times where the messages were too long to type, so you'd be voice noting each other back and forth, like, oh my goodness.
Yeah,
it was never like serious, like, it was just, I think it was just our passion.
Yeah, the passion between us both. Because let's go on to him. Tom is very passionate and he's a perfectionist as well. Like he is. He is a perfectionist. But I just think our visions on this were too different. But like I've said it on other podcasts when you haven't been here, and I've just said, like, you know, like without Tom, I don't think this would have, and we all agree on this, it would not have kicked up the way it did. We wouldn't have had the same vision. There was things that he would like, I would want to do, and he'd be like, no, wait at bay. And then like, we'd do it then, and he'd be like, I told you so. And like, I'd be like, yeah, you're right. And I'll always respect him for that, you know? And how is Tom, like, from your perspective?
Tom's doing really well. Yeah. At that time in the Central Club, I think towards the end, you could see he was taking a toll mentally with everything he was trying to juggle in his personal life, and which was obviously reflecting on the Central Club. So every time he had an idea for the Central Club that wasn't aligned with your vision, like you were just saying, you would clash heads, and then, you know, it gets toxic, don't it? Do you know what I mean? So it's better to just shake hands and call it a day. And I think Tom's... like right now, since he's not been on the podcast, you know, obviously you speak to him, you're still in contact with him, he's doing really well.
Yeah. I've spoken to him. I haven't spoken to him loads, but I have spoken, and he seems like he's in a good place. And yeah, he was cracking up at a point as well, weren't he? Because he did take a step back for many of reasons. And the kids, how old is he?
He's 24.
He's 24. And like, he does a lot, don't he? Like, and he tries to take on the world. That's the truth.
Tom.
He tries to take on the world. Would you say so?
But yeah, that's exactly what I'd say. If Tom doesn't need my advice, but if I was to give him some, I'd just tell him like to slow down and just like grow as a person, you know, because he's always just on to the next thing. And he'd say, well, that's why I'm going to be able to do this and you're not. But just like mature as a person, just, you know, live life as an everyday person. You don't always have to look at the next thing. Enjoy the now, enjoy the journey rather than just be, what's that?
You're bang on, because this is the thing I say with Tom. This is this is the conversations we have. Tom is so serious and so 100%, and he wants to be so professional, and he wants to be taken serious all the time. And the way I feel is don't grow up too fast, bro.
Yeah.
When you're going to look back, you want to be 35 now. Okay, you want to be taken serious. You want to look like an adult. You want to look like you're 35 now. But when you're 35, ain't you going to think, right, I wish I weren't 35 when I was 24. Do you get me? You grew up way too fast because you only get one life. You can't turn that back.
Mm-hmm.
No amount of money. I'm not saying Tom's out here for money and that. Like, no, but he wants to be great. Ambitious, he wants greatness. But no amount of money can take back time.
It's a weird one, isn't it? Because, you know, we talk about how he's always on to the next, but then when it comes to the Central Club and I was thinking of ideas, he would be the one to tell me to slow down. Wait. And it's weird, isn't it?
Yeah.
Because maybe if he has a project, he will be, he takes his time with it as much as he can. But if he's not done with that, he's on to another project quickly. I don't know. It's a mad one, isn't it? But
yeah, he's broad and also tunnel vision. So he's like chooses loads of stuff and then he can tunnel in on it.
What I found with Tom is, he will put his all into something and he will take his time and he'll read into it and he'll make sure that, you know, he does everything with it. But if you come with an idea from that, Nah, there's no telling him and there's no... He's got the answer already, like, type of thing. And then, like, and if you do something wrong, he'd tell you this. And sometimes that was quite offensive. Okay, I need someone to tell me when I'm going wrong. But sometimes it was like, I'm fucking 32. I'm not 32. I'm making a name. I'm 30 years of age, Tom. Like, I know as well. Like, don't speak to me like a kid. And he could get away with it with probably eight out of 10 people. But there's always going to be them people who will say no, mate. Like, you know. Mm. But, you know, even so, like, I respect him. You know, I wish him all the best in his life. And, you know, what he done here when he started, like, I'll always hold him in high regard for that, you know?
Yeah, it's good, man. I've got enough respect for Tom. Enough respect.
Just to top that,
There's one more other thing I want to say as well with myself, but go on.
Look, there's also a side to Tom that is like really funny and charismatic. And when it worked here, it really worked. Yeah. Do you know what I mean? And that's why I just like to see more of it, Tom, because me and Dan have spent loads of time with him as well. He is a laugh. Do you know what I mean? And
100%. People don't see that. He doesn't. I think Tom's problem is not letting people see that. Like,
He is funny. He's so childish and funny when he wants to be. And it's like, do you know what? Yeah. This guy is a laugh. Like,
yeah, yeah. He wants to be taken serious. And I think that can sometimes get the better of him.
Yeah. There is one question I want to ask you, though, about the Tom situation. Did you ever feel like you couldn't be yourself on this podcast because of Tom being your boss?
Tom being on the podcast and being my boss working, you know, in my day job, obviously that has an impact. That's going to have an impact on you. Do you know what I mean? Like, you're with each other all the time and you have so many relationships, you know, friendly, work relationship, professional, and if you are a bit confused.
Yeah.
Do you know what I'm saying? So sometimes at the time, our relationship was confusing when we were on the podcast, which made me feel maybe slightly different. But since he's been off the podcast, we got on like, we get along like, what's the word? Butter.
House on fire.
House on fire.
Butter. Yeah, I don't like butter.
I like wildfire.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So,
Dan's like, what?
Yeah. This, like him taking a step away, and it's made our relationship better as well, I think.
Yeah, that's good. That's good.
Yeah.
You know, when I last saw him, I know I'm not going to speak for him, but like he looked like he was onto another project and as he does, but he looked like he was very relaxed and very chilled and knew what he wanted. So that's good, you know, and I wish Tom all the best. I really do. What's going on in your life, Lukah? Why didn't you tell the people why you stepped away in the first place and maybe where we're at now?
Yeah, so it just started getting... What happened was the podcast started getting really intense and I had some stuff going on in my personal life where it was taking a lot of my time, which I couldn't then put into the Central Club, which was needed because the Central Club essentially is a full-time job.
Let's explain to people how is it easy to run a podcast? Because I thought it was going to be a lot easier than it fucking is.
Is it fuck?
Yeah, it's not. It's not really easy.
Sometimes I feel guilty with you as well because you've got other jobs. Like this ain't your full-time job, Harrison.
Yeah.
And sometimes I'm like, fucking hell, he's ringing me. He should be working, but he's doing Central Club. It's like, there's a lot of work in Central Club, isn't it?
My working hours, I contribute to the Central Club more than anything else. And it is hard going. It does get on top a bit, but I enjoy it. So that's why I always end up putting it before my other work.
You should always enjoy your work, shouldn't
you?
I've done it with my work as well.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. So
it is a lot of stress because we're striving for like perfection, do you know what I mean? And there's a big space out there that we're trying to get noticed in, you know what I mean? YouTube, for God's sake. Like, there's millions and millions of content creators out there that we're trying to compete with.
Yeah, I think our unique part is the fact that we're from Cardiff. And when you look at Cardiff, there are other podcasts and stuff, but there's no big platform that's for the city. Like, look at the bloody logo, like the skyline of the city. We you know, we're doing it for Cardiff.
Yeah. In a way, though, you could say that's tying us down, but I do think we get rich pickings of Welsh guests, definitely. Like, people want to come and share their story on the Central Club. We get loads of people who you'd be like, what, he wants to come on? And if we were based in Hereford or fucking Bristol or somewhere like that, they probably wouldn't come on.
It's all worth it when we look at the people we've met. Do you know what I mean? It's absolutely amazing. Like, these are people like that, you know, my dad used to speak about, or like what I got brought up on. Do you know what I mean? The likes of Colin Jackson, which should be up by now, Craig Bellamy. Do you know what I mean? The list goes on and
you,
on.
Like, it's people you would see on TV when you were a youngster and now you're in the same room with them conversing.
Yeah.
And it's like, how the fuck did that just happen?
Yeah.
And Dan guests you know, he wears the t-shirt around and he gets people pulling him and like, oh, you watch the Sandra Club. No, we work for it. Do you know what I mean? It's amazing.
You are.
It's good.
Yeah, we are literally.
It's funny when you get looks on the street and it's like, oh, he knows Cullen. I don't know Cullen.
I fucking hate him, the asshole. Yeah.
That's an amazing feeling, isn't it, though? Like, you know, people like the fact that people are seeing the merch and they're like, oh,
yeah. Before it's even out.
Yeah, yeah.
Not even out yet.
Yeah.
10,000 subscribers and we'll have it out.
It's going to be out by now.
Yeah, probably be out by now, 10K, yeah.
By the time this video goes out.
Yeah. 100%. Colin Jackson. Yeah, he'll push it for us. I'm telling you.
I can't wait, man. The merch, like, that's... I can't wait for that to come out, bro.
So, obviously, like, we've had this conversation as well with ourselves, but I want to know your personal opinion on it for the merch. Central Club... logo or just the skyline?
I like the logo at the bottom of the hoodie. Yeah, that's a fresh design. And on the hats, you know, like the brim, the
hood.
The hood of the hat.
So if we had hats, would you just have the skyline? Do you think?
Yeah, just the skyline. I reckon both.
Yeah,
a little bit of versatility.
Versatility, is it versatility? Yeah, it is.
Versatility.
Yeah, no, it's a good thing. And, you know, the people I have pulled me is just unbelievable, crazy. The fact that I done a speech the other day in the Senate, and it weren't for my work, it was as the Central Club podcast.
And I can't believe that,
you know,
bro.
Politicians, head of police, head of prisons, and like we're talking as the Central Club, like it's fucking crazy.
Have you got footage of that?
I've got footage of it, yeah. And I'm thinking about, I will put it up on the, it'll be up by now. Everything should be up by now. But yeah, like, I do think, you know.
Do you want to talk a bit about that? Like what actually happened? Because I wasn't there, was I? So I don't
know. All right, I'll briefly touch on before we can go back to you. Decriminalization and diversion. So, you know, in Portugal and places like that, you've got, you know, harm reduction. These places where it's all about addiction, obviously, and trying to make the world a better place. So I got reached out by Martin Blakeborough, who we have interviewed. Shout out to Martin Blakeborough and Kaleidoscope to talk about my experiences as a drug addict, my time in prison and with my run-ins with the law. And what could have been done different in my life, you know, what kind of things would have helped me? Should I have went to prison? Did prison do the right thing for me? That type of thing. So I had to go there and tell my life story. And then from that, then tell them what I think would work and what worked for me and what didn't work for me. So I was just ranting on about the prison services and how I don't think, you know, low level crime, as in shoplifting, anything drug related, should not go to prison. They should be given a chance. You know, when people get that criminal record, it's game over. People just feel like their lives are over. People don't they're not educated enough to know that even with a criminal record, you can still get a job. And you know, they're quick enough to just send people to jail instead of looking for other sort of help for them. And that's what my argument was, and my speech was based around. And then we had Jason Q, who was the private police commissioner or something with Theresa May. He had a lot of run-ins with drug. He had his views on drug addiction. He was very strict on it. And then he had like some sort of intervention in his life halfway through being a police officer and ended up turning it around. And now he's for, you know, trying to decriminalize it. And then we had David, I don't want to get his surname wrong, but he's another police commissioner, politician of Powys. So we were the three speaking. I opened the bill, which was nerve-wracking as hell. The whole room was full with all these important people. And then at the end, they asked us questions, and we had like we had someone from Portugal come up and answer questions. We had people from prisons, people from all different services. And the idea I got from it is that they're trying to now do a big thing called diversion, and what that is. So, you know, when people get arrested, they might get caught with heroin, they might get caught with something. Instead of sending them to prison, instead of giving them a criminal record or charging them or taking them to court, they will refer them straight to a drug service. Now, they're doing that anyway in certain places like Midlands Police, Cumbria, Avon Somerset, them type of places. They're trying to do it in South Wales. Now, there have been places that have done diversion anyway, but what I said was, I'm more worried about people who get caught, like myself, for shoplifting. Like, I got caught shoplifting, and it was down to drugs. But what happens if I go down now and I get caught, arrested for shoplifting, 10 shoplifts, I've got drugs in my system, will they divert that? And they said that's what they're trying to do now. So not just getting caught with something, because half of the time drug users don't get caught with drugs because they're probably taking it. They get caught stealing, they get caught burgling, they get caught criminal, you know, robbing someone. And they're trying to now divert them crimes. So if, like I said, get caught, I'll go in, they'll say, have you been taking drugs, what's your problems? Yeah, I'm addicted to heroin, that's why I've done the shoplifting. Great, instead of charging you with shoplift and potential prison, we are now going to divert you to these services. And that's what it was all about. Also trying to do harm reduction, so injecting places to safely inject instead of being all around the streets. So it was really good, really interesting. It was another experience for me, another tick off the box of what I've done. Since I've seen you as well, I've also I've been asked to go back again to do youth workshops, so that's really good. And we're now in the midst of trying to take the Central Club to another level with these type of agencies and services. So everything's very exciting, and we'll just see where the next step takes us. But on to you again. I want to go back to you. So you said you know everything was hectic in your life. Yeah, and I know. I even told people online, Lukah's having a baby. Yeah. Lukah's having a baby. That's what everyone knows. So how like, I know you're going through some stuff. Are you able to share any of this and let the people know?
The time I was away, obviously there's a lot of highs and lows. So obviously one of the highs is I'm having a baby.
Way.
So that's, you know, that's mad news because this is my first baby. I've never had one before. and then there's also a lot of stresses that come with that, I guess. So like, I'm quite young. I wasn't exactly ready for this baby. You know, with my partner, had I asked her for a baby, she probably would have said, shut the fuck up. You know, we weren't really in that part of our life, but it's come our way and this is how we're dealing with it. So, you know, we haven't got our finances in check or, you know, a place to live or anything. So, you know, we've got all these worries on top of my head. Plus, you know, this baby's coming in. So we want to I want to just engrave the best possible life I possibly can for this child now, because it's now become my number one priority. Like this baby, I want to, ever since I was young, I've always wanted to be a good dad. You know, that's like one of my biggest goals in life. I've always wanted to be a sick dad. So, I'm just trying to make it happen. And it's like, sometimes the odds are against you a bit, but you just got to keep fighting, haven't you, and working it out. But I couldn't put 100% into the Central Club. I just had other stuff going on. Do you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, no, that's fine. And probably all the times you said, this problem I got, I have to put 100% and I move on to things and I get... You used to say, you know, I'd get fascinated with things and I'd be all in on stuff. But for once now, you can use that for good with your baby, and you can be the best dad possible. I know, when you found out the news, you was working extra days because you want to make sure you've got that money for that kid, and that's amazing, bro. I would never question you or moan that you had to step away for that. Do you know what I mean? This is for good. This is a good reason.
I'm exhausted, because I'm working 6 days a week, and I'm also working Deliveroo when I can.
Fucking hell, mate.
So I'm really trying to, you know, help support our family. Do you know what I mean? Yeah. I'm trying to build stable legs.
Yeah. Obviously, there's some news you've got with the baby as well.
Yeah.
Are you allowed to go in about any of that? Or?
Yeah, of course. When I found out, it was Christmas Eve, and it was the best news, but the most confusing news, because we didn't know what we were going to do. We had obviously a good few conversations and decided that we were going to keep the kid, because we just want to give it a good chance. And then we went in for the scan to find out, not the gender, but it was the gender scan. So I think that's about 20 weeks or whatever. So we went to Landark Hospital, and the doctor scanned my partner, and found an abnormality with the brain. So there's a millimeter gap in your brain, which when you're a fetus is there, is present. And then when you're born, that millimeter gap closes. So it's part of the brain development. That millimeter gap, the doctor couldn't find, right? So they'd be like, ooh, something a bit, yeah, bit off here. I think you should probably come back for another scan just so we can have a check. And but I wouldn't worry too much. So me and Satch were obviously like a bit thinking, if it was really serious, they would have said there and then it was serious. So we went off fine. We weren't even thinking about it. So we went back in for the scan and then the doctor scanned the brain and you could see his eyebrows were kind of going up. And it was like me and Satch were looking at each other thinking, what's going on? You know, what's, is our baby okay? And yeah, this, he just basically confirmed that the millimeter gap unfortunately wasn't present. Like it couldn't be, they don't know, there's nothing there. The thing is though, when you're such early on in your pregnancy, the baby's obviously really small and growing. So it's hard for them to see such a small baby, especially on a 2D scan. So what they do is they booked us in for a brain MRI scan. So we had to travel to Bristol. And we went to Bristol and then we had this MRI scan. And then once we had the results, the doctor basically said, look, you know, that this is indefinite now, like the 2D scan maybe, but this, we've had the MRI, there's like, there's an abnormality with the brain.
So just to, kind of be clear with this. So are you saying that the brain is already touching the skull? Is that what you're saying? Because if you're saying when it, there's a meter, so, and when they're born,
so the the millimeter gap is in the brain, right? Like the brain is like...
There's like a hole in it.
Yeah, pretty much, yeah. Which obviously compresses... I'm not a scientist. I haven't got a Scooby-Doo what I'm talking about. But that closes once the brain, once the baby's born. That's like how it normally goes.
So are they worried that like when it burns, it might like inflate or something or...
No. So what they're saying is, right, it's already closed.
Okay.
It hasn't... But so this is something they see sometimes. Sometimes it happens. Which could be a risk of X, Y, and Z. Once we had the results, they had to lay us down all the risks of what this could be. But the doctor said, you know, sometimes children are born with this and they live a completely normal life and there's nothing wrong with them at all. You know, they don't even know they've got anything wrong with their brain. So me and Satch were, it's weird because they're giving you their this information and they're telling this, they're saying it might be okay and you're just confused because there's no definitive answer. You're not walking away thinking, yeah, the baby's fine, and you're not thinking oh, the baby's fucked. So you're like,
would you rather have them just kind of give you an answer, yeah, whether it's good or bad? Like,
I remember when Kobe Fowers was on about talking about sitting in limbo. Obviously he's
shit out to Kobe as well. I think he's all clear right now.
Yeah, wicked stuff. Amazing. Man, that's heartwarming, that.
Yeah,
is.
Yeah, well done, man.
And but yeah, I remember him talking about, you know, situations where, you know, you're in limbo and you don't know and you just want to know, which is now I can relate to more than ever because you want to know. Well, I say that actually, my mindset has changed a bit as this has gone on. So me and Satch sat down and said to each other, look, you know, if this child is not going to have a good life, and it's only going to live X amount of time, is it, you know, should we go through, should we delay our pain sort of thing, you know, and consider, you know, terminating the pregnancy. So we were in this situation where we don't know because the doctor hasn't given us enough evidence for us to say, yeah, we should. Do you know what I'm trying to say? So anyway, some time goes on and we have another MRI scan, comes back. There's like a divot in the brain.
A new one, is
yeah,
it?
Yeah, yeah. So basically what they're saying is the millimeter gap is not present. And there's also on the right side of the brain, there's like an indentation, which means it's not formed properly, like it hasn't correctly formed. And unfortunately, that part of the brain is a very important part of the brain. So it's a case of... What the doctor said is a case of we're going to have to just wait until the baby grows a little bit more because he's so small. We haven't got enough brain to look at Do you know what I mean? It's not fully there. So it's got to a point now where we're 33 weeks pregnant. Satch is out here. The baby's kicking. The baby's kicking. We've given the baby a name, you know.
Do you need a work uniform? Want to start a clothing brand? Or maybe you have a football kit that needs a logo printed. Well, if I was you, I'd get in touch with the Re-Inspire Printing Company down Treforest Industrial Estate for the finest printing and embroidery in Wales. I use them for my custom-made mankini, but you could use them for t-shirts, hats, hoodies, and many, many other things.
What sort of risks have they laid out for you? So what things could you be facing?
To be honest, when they say it, it's like such a shocking factor. I'm the type of person that when you say something that you don't like to hear, it just kind of goes in one ear and comes out the other. But I have got like a list anyway, so I'll say it to you. This is kind of what the doctor gave us on the first MRI scan.
Is there a name for this?
It's the C. Wait, the part of the brain that are affected is the cavum septi pellucidi, right? So all these names are proper weird. So
Latin by the song.
There's no way I'm going to remember that. Do you know what I mean? So, but this is what they said anyway in the notes. We discussed the findings. And I explained the limitations of the USS and examined the CSP. However, we next discussed the potential implications of abnormalities of the CSP/CC, including the associations with ACC and COD, with increased risk of underlying chromosomal genetic condition, risk of fine motor problems, which the doctors brought up quite a few times, risk of epilepsy, risk of cognitive impairment, risk of visual impairment. So, you know, you're looking at quite serious stuff, really.
That's a lot of stuff.
Yeah, like the baby could potentially be blind in both eyes, have problems trying to speak, you know, use his lips and stuff like that.
Motor serious means just the way they walk and stuff, I think, as well.
And then the second... The notes on the second MRI scan, I'll just get those up for you as well. Because obviously this is that's what we had initially. This is a bit more updated.
This is the data,
yeah. So the repeat fMRI has been reported and discussed at the
Sorry, bro.
Because I can't read these
words.
Read
it? Give me it.
Do you reckon?
Show me it.
I don't know.
Which ones do they mate?
It's like the whole thing, G, but.
Well, I'll rip.
You ain't going to be able to read it.
I'll read it all out. All right, yeah? Okay. The repeat fMRI has been reported as discussed as the pediatric neurology, neuroimaging, MDT in Bristol. I have spoken at length with Dr. Lux. Nice name. Regarding the result and the potential clinical implications. Sorry. In summary, the range of the clinical outcomes include the possibilities of motor dysfunction, including speech, and the potential for hemiparesis, epilepsy, soda bullet dysfunction.
Basically, loads of complicated stuff.
Yeah,
right?
It's super complicated. Yeah,
I don't know.
Overall IQ association with underlying genetic disorders, cognitive infection. On a scan today, the fetal growth is a largely follow previous centiles. Yeah, listen.
Look,
are you feeling, mate?
Look, this is the thing. It's not. I didn't have to read that out for you, but also, it's maybe someone's watching this podcast who's going through the same. Who's going through it? You get me?
Yeah.
So, we're not, I feel like I'm alone, but there's probably millions of people with this same problem. Do you know what I'm saying?
Yeah,
and it's like, you live your life and you think there's going to be no problem. Like, you don't think there's not going to be no problems. You obviously know, but you never expect innit? Do you know what I mean? So this is...
you expect that it's going to dodge you and just you're going to be okay, but...
Yeah, that's it, man. I thought my baby boy was going to be all right, like, do you get me? So...
You don't write it off yet, bro. Listen.
I'm not writing it
we
off.
We see all I'm, these videos look, on fucking YouTube and TikTok. Mike, they said my kid would be this. Yeah. And then it's like, he's fine.
Yeah. You know? That's it.
You got to hold on. Well, I say you got to hold on to hope. But like, I'm assuming that's what you're going to do.
Yeah. Well, like what I was saying earlier about, you know, potentially terminating the pregnancy. I feel like we're past that now. Like we absolutely gunning for this baby. And if the doctor said to us that there's a sliver of hope, then we're sliding in for that full pelt. Do you get me? And we're gonna have this baby. And whatever it is, whatever the situation is, it's gonna be loved,
mate. This is what people need to fucking look at, mate. This is what people need to look at and hold on to and see when people go through their lives struggling and thinking that the odds are stacked up against them. Look at someone like Lukah. Look, they're from doctors. This is what they're putting down as near enough certainties. And, you know, he's going through this 100%, the same as Kobe did, the same as you are right now. And people need to look at this and be inspired by this. And like you said, if there's anyone else who's in a similar situation, I hope this helps them, Lukah. Yeah. You're a fucking brave man, mate, and I fucking love you.
Yeah, man. So, but anyways, me and the missus, this is like the first time I've actually even cried about it, because me and the missus, I'm not crying like I'm all right, but me and the missus have been happy. We've been good. We've been optimistic. And I still am. We're still happy. We're still feeling good. And yeah, we're just going to keep gunning for it, man. You can't let things like this get to you. And whatever life throws at you, you've got to learn to dodge or to go with it. Or yeah, do you know what I'm trying to say? It's not about trying to fight that thing that comes against
you. You're working 6 days a fucking week. You're doing like... fucking deliver it when your day's off. You know, you're doing everything you can to provide for this baby, and you've got that telling you, you know, elsewhere, if that's the way. You've got that telling you other. Like, what you're doing, mate, is you should be an example for a lot of people. A lot of people.
I don't want to be, like, there are people out there at the end of the day who are in a worse situation. I'm not really anyone special, really. I'm just doing what I think I should be doing, and I just hope that people learn that they should do what they think they should do and just go for it. Do you know what I mean?
So, how's mum with all this? What does she?
Really supportive. She's she's taking us in, because obviously we don't have a place to live, so my house is a bit overcrowded at the moment. So my little brother is going to have to shift a bit into a smaller room.
Yeah.
My mum's going to just stay on the sofa, and we're going to have that room, me and missus and the baby, until we get on our feet. And then, yeah, so my mum's at my absolute rock right now. She's supporting us, yeah.
Big up, Kelly.
Big up.
A legend.
Big up, Kel.
Oh, Sash.
Kelmeister. Yeah, she's good. It's a bit more emotional, you know. Anyway, I can imagine being pregnant. That's just one of the symptoms. But she's overall happy, because, like, we love this baby. You know, already we absolutely adore this baby. And, you know, whenever the baby's kicking, you know, it kicks like mad, and he does little rollies, pollies in her belly, and we love him. Do you know what I mean? So,
well, this is one thing I would say is so they're not saying, you know, it's not like. With some babies, they say, like, you know, it's not going to survive when it comes up. It's going to die, or it's going to have a stillbirth, this type of stuff.
Exactly.
Yours is just saying that it's going to have defects, basically. Mm-hmm. Yeah? And I know you, like, you'll love... You, that's nothing to you. Like, I know that you would love that baby, whatever was wrong with it.
100%, man. 100%.
You know, there's some people out there that would probably say, well, would we want to put the baby in this type of world? What would you say to those people who would say, why are you bringing a baby into this world?
Well, I would probably say, look, me and Satch, we took that risk initially. And if anyone else has a baby or decides to have a baby, you've taken that risk anyway. Do you know what I'm saying? So you've just got to be able to deal with it.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean?
So that's a good answer, that is. Yeah. For anyone, you just shut the fuck up. That's it.
Exactly. As soon as you put that in the hole, Do you know what I'm trying to say?
Yeah.
You've taken that risk. You should be able, you should man up and deal with it.
Yeah.
Straight up. And if you're struggling to deal with it, then seek support, because you know it's not the end, is it? Do you know what I mean? So you just gotta seek support and get the right people around you. But otherwise, just man the fuck up and deal with it.
Yeah.
100%.
Anything you wanna say on Lukah's baby?
Not too much more, really. I think we've talked about it quite a bit, haven't we? But it is a bit of a taboo subject, like, you know, termination of pregnancies and stuff. And I don't think either or is right or wrong. Like, it is personal to each person.
I think see it the natural way out.
Do you think?
Mm.
It's tough. I'll tell you why it's tough. It's because initially me and Satch thought that if this baby was absolutely not going to have a chance at living, then we would just terminate it then, just to ease our pain, just for it to be over.
Maybe not a total chance of living, but it's not that, is it?
Look, there are miracle babies. There are babies who are told all of this, that are born and are perfectly fine.
Yeah, and at the end of the day, you will be kicking yourself thinking, what if?
Exactly.
So that's why I said the natural way out, because like, I just think, you know, 100 years ago, 200 years ago, when they didn't have that that technology, you just see the natural way out. Okay, if it has defects, you deal with it. Like, that's my take. You know, if they did say 100% it's not going to, then you wouldn't want to put the baby through that. We're very blessed that we've got technology like that. But, you know, just try and... It's hard. And Lukah, I'm with you, mate.
To be honest, yeah, you saying that, if that was generally the thought process of, like, society, that's just what you do, you wouldn't have had that struggle of whether we terminate or not. Do you know what I mean? It's just the way things go. So maybe that would have... you know, saved you of a lot of stress, like even having to debate that, because that's a horrible thing to try and
like hearing about the process. Like, I feel so sorry for anybody that has to go through that, because when I heard that process, it just ripped my heart in half, because it's not a nice thing to talk about with your doctor, you know, how the whole thing goes down. So people that have had to have an abortion and felt that was the only way, I really, really do feel for, like, I can really resonate with how they must feel right now.
And there's obviously different situations of why people abort babies. You know, not standing a chance is just one of them. You know, there could be people who are having they were raped by their father and now they're having a kid and they don't want to bring that kid into that world. There's many different ways of why people have abortions, but it's horrible when it's like, you know, virtually developed.
There's actually legalities to it. So the doctor said, once you get past a certain point of your pregnancy, you need to be signed by two doctors to say, okay, this is a situation where...
You can't do it in Wales either, can you?
No, you can.
Oh, they're allowed nowadays?
Yeah, so the doctor, obviously this is, well...
One of the boys had to go to England.
Oh, sorry. Your doctors in Wales can sign you off, and then you'll go to England to have your abortion. I'm clueless on that, so that might be right. That might be wrong. But the doctor did give me the ultimatum, or the option to, if you want to go there, we could sort of do that. And he said, you know, if you want more information, we can take a sample out of Satch's sack, the baby's sack, sorry, and they can see if it's genetical. And then I think he said, if you've got a genetical issue and also this brain issue arising together, it's a double bad, which is really bad.
Because they normally say when two different ethnic backgrounds, Satch Japanese, you got Maltese, like that's like more than likely to be a healthy baby, is that what they say? Like, I swear they say that.
I've never heard that.
Yeah. I swear I've heard it. If two Welshmen fucking have a baby, it's not as...
Well, Japanese people have really strong genes. They live the longest, actually. I'm pretty sure they're one of the only... species. They're like...
races.
Yeah, ethnic, race, whatever. They live the longest. Yeah. They are the longest life expectancy.
Cute babies as well.
Yeah.
Hella cute, man.
I can imagine your little boy having a little bowl cut. Little jet black bowl cut.
He's having curtains. Yeah, I'm giving him the curtains.
Oh, Luke, listen, man, we're all rooting for you. And guys, if any of you want to show some support for Luca and his missus, I'm not going to set up a GoFundMe. go and reach out to him. Give him some help. You know, living in a fucking mum's house and I like, and you know, doing 6 day fucking shifts and renting his car out. The guy is renting his car out.
Yeah. Do you know what? Someone's coming to pick up the car now today and I've left with my mum and my mum needs to go shopping. She's bloody texting me now. I know.
Well, hopefully, you know, when you're next year again, you know, the baby will be here. It will be healthy and you can bring him on and we can sit him on your lap.
I want nothing.
And do some goos and gagas.
Yeah, that's it, man.
What else has happened since Lucas? What else can we talk about? There's got to be some things. How's things been, Luke? What else have you been? Anything else? No?
Just renting my car out, working 24/7. If anyone wants to rent my car, by the way, hit me up, £30 a day. Nice.
It's a nice car as well.
Yeah. I will. I'll do my lessons. Since you have been gone, who's been your favourite guest on the Central Club?
It's a bit of a tough one, that is.
I don't know.
I asked the boys, I was like, oh yeah, who do you think the best episode is? Dougie Joyce was a...
Yeah, he was. They're looking to do a part two now as well.
Yeah.
For the paperwork and stuff, yeah.
Well, Dougie Joyce was supposed to come on originally when I was, you know, active.
Yeah.
And so a couple of things happened and he never ended up coming on, so...
But Marvin as well. Marvin's meant to be coming down and...
Yeah.
There's a few... Let's talk about that then, because literally as we're talking right now, but this will be old news by then, but we just watched the Deckard and Dean fight. Fucking hell, mate. That was... I was a bit disappointed. I was disappointed in Dean, but at the same time, I'm proud of Dean because he tried, but it was just a mismatch.
Yeah.
It was a massive mismatch in my eyes.
I think, I don't know what happened at the beginning. Dean, like something was like long, he was like long in and out or something.
Yeah. I don't know why. I think he was just getting his wraps on, but everyone was just saying he weren't showing up.
Oh, is it?
What are you going to say over there?
Yeah, I was going to say, forget about that. What about Joe Cordina's fight?
We haven't talked
about that, have we?
Fucking yeah, Cordina, man. And we had him here and we were like, yes, this guy needs a title fight.
Yeah. Manifested it, didn't he?
We said that to all the boxers.
So we made that happen.
obviously... Let's go through him, man. Liam Williams obviously lost to Eubank, unfortunately. But I spoke to Liam yesterday, actually, and he's training away now abroad. I think he's in Stuttgart for a week. So hopefully he gets back up and training again and hopefully we can get him on and, you know, manifest his future potential fights. Obviously, it was a shame what happened with Eubank and Williams. I think he was just too excited. And I think the nerves got to him. Jacob Robinson lost. Yeah, unfortunately, he's still world champion, but unlucky Jake, maybe next time, keep fighting. I had a good conversation with someone the other day. This might be a bit controversial, I don't know, but I had a good conversation with someone the other day and he reckons that Steve Robinson is holding Jake Robinson back. Like Eubank did, like Chris Eubank Sr. did. He's living in the pressures of his dad. You know, I know you're...
What do you mean by that?
So, like any interview, any comment, anything like Jacob Robinson has done, Steve's been there. He's always lived in the shadow of Steve as well. You know, his dad was world champion and Steve weren't the greatest boxer. Like he just about made it, like, you know, that's why it's such a great story. Because
Cinderella story,
yeah. So it's not like he was like technically gifted. He is a great boxer, of course, and I'll take my hat off to him. But what I'm saying is he weren't even the greatest, but everyone like says to Jake, yeah, it's Jake Robinson. It's Steve Robinson's boy, isn't it? That's what it is. It's not Jake Robinson. And, you know, he trains him and I think he's in his corner and he's there at everything. But, you know, that don't mean nothing. Like you look at Eubank. Yeah, he had his dad in his corner for a very long time and he didn't perform very well. As soon as he left his dad and went training with whoever else, whether it was Roy Jones and whoever else, it kind of like excelled him into something
Roy
else.
Jones at the moment.
Yeah, and that's what this guy was saying. He was saying his dad's holding him back, if anything.
I think you're always going to be underneath his your peer's shadow. Like if your dad's got that name and that weight, you're always going to be under the shadow until you outshine him. But if you're talking about technical ability, yeah, maybe you should take it to a different trainer and just see how it works.
Yeah, yeah.
And his dad should be more encouraging of that, if anything.
Well, what are you saying?
I think that's the case of all sports, especially boxing. You need, you know, a fresh training.
But he lives with his dad.
Yeah, I didn't get that vibe from him that is his dad, like, you know, pushing him or whatever. If anything, you sort of push him out of his shadow, if you know what I mean. But I think I haven't watched many of his fights, but he is getting on a bit.
Yeah.
Jacob.
To be in that realm of Welsh Championships and Commonwealth, you should be higher than that.
Yeah,
George.
And I think you should be bowling people over if you're really going to be a success in the sport. You know, your first few fights, you should be knocking people. You know, you should be getting through people.
Yeah, yeah.
And then you can look at, you know, how can I improve my training and stuff like that. He's maybe not shown enough already that he's actually, you know, going to be a success in this sport.
Yeah,
like,
yeah. Andrew Selby, I'm a bit lost, like, you know, like, obviously he came here and he, you know, I do know there was a lot of stuff with MTK Global that's happened with the Kinahans. He's been arrested and the FBI are looking and, you know, it's been folded. I think Tyson Fury's banned from America now. Now, I know Andrew Selby was contracted and he was holding on to that. I've got 3 years left with MTK. Well, that's gone. So I think it's going to be hard. Apparently, he's been struggling to get his deal. And I haven't seen him as active online, which is a shame. Obviously, you know, it must be hard as well. His brother's just retired. You know, there's not much of an age difference. Imagine you're trying to get into that sport. Your brother's just retired. You've just had a kickback with your contract. It's a fucking tough hill to climb, you know.
Andrew, to me, has done enough anyway. If he leaves today,
Yeah and no. It's just, he's always going to be that shoulda, woulda, coulda. He's always going to be coulda. He is. He was gifted, and everyone knows he was gifted, and everyone knows he was better than most.
Bro, people have literally compared him to, and I'm talking about guys on the street, I'm talking about professional boxers, Joe and Liam, compared him to Canelo.
He is,
you know what I mean, on a skill level.
Yeah, no, they said if Lee Selby, if it was Lee Selby's mind and Andrew's work rate, then it could have been a Canelo. That's what they said.
Yeah, I know, but they still could, you know, they still put him in those, in that category, do you know what I mean? As, you know, very, very gifted.
Anyone with two eyes can see that kid was gifted.
Yeah, I'm not saying he's not. I'm just saying, like, it is a fucking letdown. Yeah, it's like, I root for him so much.
Such a nice guy.
He's winning I just think he's winning now if he's sober, clean, happy with his boy. That's training that he's winning. He don't need to come back in that sense. Who else? Joe Cordina, of course. Fucking unbelievable. We done a watch along, me and Clara, a live watch along.
I was watching.
And my head and ears, yeah, he was. My head and ears were ringing for days after. I had a big headache. Just like, yeah, written in the stars.
We were all scared though that first round, weren't we?
Mate, that guy's a good boxer.
We thought, oh, it's not going to be another, do you know what I mean?
And when I found out it was his first title defence as well, I thought, he ain't giving up his first title. He ain't giving up on one defence. Joe Cordina, mate, fucking...
With the knockout as well, like, finished in style.
So we won back.
Yeah. It's probably one of the best knockouts ever, just because of like the occasion... Yeah. Like, in terms of, like, boxing skill, like, you know, when the purists talk about it, it's perfection. Do you know what I mean? That knockout.
Yeah.
And your reaction said it all. Like, it was gobsmacking.
Yeah, the faint jab and then boom, over a right hand. And it was
just unbelievable.
That's for anyone to sleep.
Yeah.
Mm.
But he did look shocked to see him on the floor.
Oh, yeah.
He turned around and was like, what?
Well, this is the thing. This guy knocks people out as well. So he was the favourite for the knockout. But Joey just bum, bum. Put him down.
What's next? Millennium Stadium? Principality Stadium? I don't know.
Should be. Bloody hell.
You know? It's about time though. And do you know what? To see his missus there crying and just like... It was all for that one moment in life. That's what he's worked for. And I'm so happy for him. I'm so fucking happy for him.
What do you think's next for him now? I wonder what... Like, what's...
What's the other guy who beat... Oh, what's the other guy in America? The black guy. There's another guy in here who's got...
No, I know they were trying to link him with someone straight away.
Is it?
You should try to take a chill pill for now.
Yeah, hang on a minute.
As you would.
Is he in a different category as the one who Cambosis was in, who fought? Is he Lee Selby's weight?
Don't know. I don't know.
Lights.
We don't.
We don't know fuck all about boxing.
Yeah. So
you're quite knowledgeable.
I keep up to date.
Yeah. Same in any sport, isn't it? Yeah. I'm like that. Like, yeah. I could keep up on.
We said the name, then we'd know.
Yeah.
So, like, rugby as well. Fairwater rugby team's being sponsored by a central club now, isn't it?
Nah, it's the baseball team, that is.
Oh, is it?
We got a baseball team. We sponsored the kit, sick, innit?
Yeah.
The skyline on the back.
I've seen it. How did it go the other day?
It got called off. Oh, the other day was good. The debut done well. We played Grange Albion. We all wrote each other off though before the game, just because there was the Albion and experienced side. They started last year again when baseball started again. 10 years ago, when baseball was a thing, the Albion were the team, or they were up there. So we kind of wrote ourselves off. It was the first game in 12 years for me. But I'm proud. I'm proud of the boys. I'm proud of the team.
So what happened?
When am I getting on it?
But we didn't get beat by an innings. We didn't want to get beat by an innings. That means if you go in and bat, either way, so say like we go in, you go out 2 innings, yeah? So say like we hit 50, they hit 40, yeah? And then if you hit, say like we hit 10, and then they hit 100, then we hit 10. They've beat us by an innings because our 20 is to the, so we don't have to go back into bat. Yeah. You get me? They beat us by an innings. They never beat us by an innings. So we went back into field. Like, so we were proud of that. And we're on for the next game. Listen, when we get our team, obviously when this goes out, if we get our team back, we'll be decent. And the Albion said they were really surprised by us. We haven't played in 12 years, half of us. So we done well.
Yeah, nice.
What was you going to say?
I was going to say, get me on there, bruv.
If you want to play, bro, we got training this week.
My swings are good, man.
We had this one kid come, right? Yeah, and he come with an American baseball mitt and a fucking bat.
with the hat.
Yeah. What, with the one hat with like the box on the side? Yeah.
Is it not that one?
Oh, he's coming with a Patterson will come with a big softball like that.
What's your bowler like? Because I can actually bowl.
It's
good.
Underarm, but it's not overarm.
No, I know, but it's underarm.
So it's pointless. Is
Lewis Bradshaw. Lewis Bradshaw.
Is he bowler. Good?
Oh, sick bowler. Yeah.
Right. I'm all right at cricket.
You should come down. He's not there sometimes.
Yeah, no.
Oh, is it? Look, anything else we could talk about? Like this? Come on, this is Lukah. Lukah, like, what's happening? You're going to come back Central Club? Like, what do you want to do?
Yeah, of course. I want to be, I'm always going to be a part of it, regardless. Whether I'll have enough time to do certain things or, look, I'm just sorting myself out right now.
Oh, it's a bit of pressure there. Really. Yeah. I should have said that. Cut that.
No,
obviously, just like I said, doors open for you. We'd love to do some extra content. We're looking to film out of the, we've said this for ages, but we're there nearly, and we're going to start doing content out of the studio, and we'd love for you to come along, bring your camera and be part of it with us.
Obviously, it's a family, it always will be, and I those extra bits of content, I'm all over. So, I'm going to be there with my little camera, standard. Yeah. Also, I've made a little top myself, a little 6pm piece.
Pick up 6pm, gang.
Music. I've got a song coming out as well.
With who?
LM.
Tom Sage.
With LM, a little garage song, and it's going to come out next
week. Well, Summertime Sun.
It's a Summertime Sun, Summertime Sun, yeah.
It's a banger, to be fair.
Have you heard it?
Yeah, we heard it when it was meant
to come out. Yeah. Last
No, but this
we got a tune we made 3 years ago, but we're going to drop it this year. I promise.
Like last year, we did make it last year, but I didn't feel like I wanted to drop it that last summer.
Because I hear Tom's making music now.
Tom's got a studio, a music studio.
No, I hear Tom's making music. So is he pressurizing you to make music?
Listen.
Is it rubbing off on you? Like
maybe. Yeah. Look,
definitely.
Tom is making a music studio and he's doing music. Growing up, I was always part of music, in the youth club and that, making tunes. People would spit a few bars, you video it. And then, when I started getting into my teenagers, I started drum and bass, becoming a drum and bass MC. And we've done loads of shows in Cardiff, in Swansea. I loved MCing, so music will always be a thing, and sometimes I go in the studio and make a little tune. This time last year, me and you made the track.
In
the studio. Yeah. But I don't know, I feel like I just want to drop it because it's just
Manscape is still popping, isn't it? People are starting to notice it now, like, and they're like rating it.
Oh yeah.
So it's a shame, man, because we done really well, didn't we, on that?
Sick, that video.
Yeah. But yeah, I'm glad you're doing what you love.
Mm.
You know, and it's good to have you back, mate. It's good to have you back.
Thanks honestly. For having me on.
No, So now we finish off with would you rather, I guess.
That's it.
All right, so the first one is, are you a mild or a spice? No, wait there. The first one is Tom or Cullen.
You're both twats.
Cut it a draw, boys. Cut it a draw.
Cut it a draw.
Nah, that was good. Cut it a draw.
Sorry, guys, we just watched the bare knuckle fight.
Yeah. No draw.
Okay, are you a mild or a spice?
I'd like to think I'm a spice, but I'm a mild.
Yeah.
I try spice. I do, but I'm probably more of a mild guy. But then,
okay. Are you a flat earther or a round earther? We've had this conversation.
I am a round earther. The reason I think I'm a round earther, we've obviously had this conversation. When you look at water, it bends. And when you look at the moon, it's circular. But I cannot lie, it does look flat. It looks flat. So I get why people think it's flat, and it might be.
Yeah, there's no proof.
Insignificant evidence.
Yeah. If you could explore one of these, deep sea or deep space?
I would search deep space. Yeah. Reason I'd search deep space is because I'm shit scared of the sea, A. And B, I have a theory that, life travels on to different galaxies and different, worlds and stuff. So human entities, you know, when we project or when we leave our bodies, you know, we travel the solar system and the universe. So,
That's a mad theory.
Yeah, that's what I think. That's what they're there for. Otherwise, why the fuck are those rocks in the sky?
Yeah, maybe. And two superpowers, one for yourself, one for humanity.
I think one for myself would probably be to just like any money I wanted, I could just shoot it out of my hands, like like that, just money. And then superpower would be for everyone to just be healthy. And take away diseases and, you know, stuff like that. Yeah, I think I would like to see the earth where there's no, you just live your life and everyone lives their life, you get me? So.
Look down that camera, Lukah. If there's one final thing you would like to tell the people, anything inspiration, any news, any like setting the record straight, it's your time, kid.
Set the record straight. Look. Lukah, you owe me fucking 20 quid. No, I'm joking. Cut that. Just keep your head up. If there's ever a chance where, if you're in a position where life's taking its toll on you and there's a chance for you to make it out on the other side, you just got to keep gunning for it. And like I said before, you build that network support, get the right people around you, and seek help. There's nothing, you know, like they say, it's okay to be not okay. And it's true, man. Like some people think, I'm stressed about this situation, but I don't want to let anyone know. It's weakness. Nah, it's not weakness, bro. Weakness is hiding it. That's weakness. If you're feeling down about something and you can, and you're looking for someone to help you, that's strength. That's not weakness.
I like that, bro.
Yeah, that's about it. Yeah.
Bro, Lukah, honestly.
Thank you so much for having me on.
Yeah, bro. Anytime, mate. You know that you're more than welcome anytime. Guys, I hope you enjoyed this one. It was a bit different. You know, we went off the cuff, and I think rightly so with Lukah. I'm just glad he's back where he belongs, and hopefully we'll see more of Lukah. We wish him all the best. Stay central.
Yo, just one last thing. I love you guys.
Go on.
3, 2, 1.
Stay central.
The Central Club.